Salamta, Rastafari, Beta Seb. Shalom and greetings to the Rastafari family. This week is interesting. This week's Rastafari is a bit of a study. Is number 48, Ferarochen, or Shoftim in the Hebraic. And the initiating words for this reading are judges and officers shalt thou make thee. And it's so interesting. Judgment has much to do with this. With this Torah portion studies, and although it is not the Sabbath, I felt it necessary to testify to works and so on and so forth. So let us continue. It's going to be very interesting to see how the rest of the body of Christos in our Father Rastafari react to this. Because if we go to Deuteronomy chapter 17, which is incorporated to Rastafari Sabbatical study number 48, you'll come to read, you know, if let us begin in chapter 17, verse number 2. If there be found among you within any of thy gates, which the Lord thy God giveth thee, man or woman that hath wrought wickedness in the sight of the Lord thy God in transgressing his covenant, and hath gone and served other gods, and worshipped them, either the sun or the moon, or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded, and it be told thee, and thou hast heard of it, and inquired diligently, and behold, it be true, and the thing certain that such abomination is wrought in Israel. You see, it's you know, if you've seen any of the previous videos, you could quickly distinguish what this is about. And you know, I'm just gonna testify to the truth, and I still stand with the information I presented, because I did not worship any stars and or the sun or moon. They are, in fact, the creation of the Almighty God, Jah, that is good. And how can we ignore it, you know? If we go to Genesis, the first chapter. If we go to Genesis, chapter 1, and we... review or read verse number 14, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs, and for seasons, and for days, and for years. So this, and the fact that you know, Imperial Ethiopia and ancient Hebraic records testify to the fact that there's always been a calendar, and including verse 14 of chapter 1, the book of Genesis, how the stars, moon, and suns, the host of heaven, are indeed for seasons, days, and, you know, and signs even. So, you know, I fear not regarding that matter, because for obvious reason, you know. Now, even more important than that is chapter 18, because Deuteronomy chapter 18 is concerning. Oh no! You know what? Excuse, I forgive. I for that. It's still chapter 17 towards the end. Sitteth upon the throne, yeah, of his kingdom. And so it's making reference to a kingly character. And so, you know, being that it is not yet the Sabbath, I and I are not gonna go into that, because it is not yet time. But being that you know, this channel doesn't have a large multitude of viewers, I felt it'd be reasonable to put this out ahead of time, you know, and just just for the record, you know, because because it, I know for a fact that it could be misinterpreted, or some of the information that I and I personally have presented could be misinterpreted in many different ways, as I will go on to discuss, because to clarify some other matters that are obviously very easy to misinterpret. And so, but first, I never strayed from Kedamawi Khaile Shilasi Negusha Negesht. You know, so Yume Igziab here. I can't get that right. This is who I and I worship. His Imperial Majesty, the first power of the Trinity. You know? I and I never pretended or assumed for 1 minute, 1 second to worship the stars or anything like that. Rather the Creator, you know? Kedamawi Khaile Shilasi, as far as Getachin Jesus Christos. You know, I don't have the picture that the LOJ Society, more specifically Prasayodinus, that he uses, but something similar and I'm sure acceptable is this I and I depiction of Jesus Christos, you know? I'm never astraying from the fact and the truth of his humanity. And, you know, I'm not saying that ones were alleging that I was not about that, but just for further clarification or just to clear any doubts, because, you know, as many are aware, we speak, but, you know, communication is a big deal because we speak and nobody listens. Well, not nobody, but it's difficult because we've been trained and programmed not to listen. And so, for example, I have used the speech, you know, until the philosophy. But because I did not mention that I was not, you know, inferring that the color of His Majesty and Yehoshua or Yeshua HaMashiach, that their humanity was that somehow the philosophy speech kind of like gave way to accepting a white Jesus Christos, that was not the case, because I did not say because I did not clearly say that one could just assume that that's what I meant, and that was not the case. I have used the philosophy speech, but in the context of Rastafari, how we are supposed to view the world, and but that's totally different and separate from truth. Truth is truth. Jesus Christos is a black Ethiopian. And I, like many others, know that for a fact and are not ashamed. You know, that's a fact. That is what is, you know, not because I've mentioned many times how the equality of humanity is necessary in order to continue forward. In no way does that mean that I seek like somehow to not make clear the true humanity of Christ and his kingly character and Jesus Christos. Excuse I for not being able to express this correctly, but you know, since it's not really an issue that that I even have, you know, because I know who Jesus Christos is. I seem to not be able to explain it all that clear, but I'm throwing this out there because after reasoning with some brothers, you know, I commented on the speech, and the reaction was that maybe I was kind of like advertising or supporting the idea that any color Jesus is okay, and that's not the case. You know, that's the only reason I'm mentioning this. It's not because someone said or anything, but because you know, if one or two can kind of be misled, then I don't know how many out there were maybe discouraged by the messages that I put out there. So I couldn't explain that perfectly, but do know that that I personally do know the true humanity of Jesus Christus as a black Ethiopian, as well as His Imperial Majesty, and I never intended to make believe or mislead others to pretend that I was okay with any whitewashing images or anything like that. As a matter of fact, I'm totally against that, and I believe I have presented the case in various different videos and, you know, so on and so forth. Now, continuing the fact that of the Gentiles, you know, this next clarification is concerning, it was inspired by the Gentile conversation in the Ethiopian World Net when the Biadon addressing the issue. I just wanted to make clear that I know who I am, and I know who Judah is, and I have no problem with that. And being that this Torah studies are Perarochen and Shoftim, judges and officers, thou shalt make me, and the whole judgment and this concerning judgment. You know, I remembered when Yehoshua said that, you know, if one judgeth himself, what need doth he that another judge him, right? And so I'm gonna go on forward and judge I myself, you know, because there's no need for others. Well, okay, if I happen to not judge correctly, of course there is need for others to judge, but first here I guess. I've spoken plenty on humiliation and being and humbling thyself, and so if I were not to humble myself in this instant, then all whatever I would have said in the past would have been false. And so I take this opportunity with much pride and honor and no shame to say that if you know, the Ethiopian Hebrew descendants are to be of a higher standard than any other peoples in the world, then, you know, I really don't mind. I really don't care, because you know, I'm not worshiping the people, you know, rather His Imperial Majesty. And it's not to say that I think that such people are not what they are. It's just that, you know, my covenant is with the Most High, with the Most High God, Jah, Rastafari. You know, even Kedemawi, Haile Selassie, the King of Kings of Ethiopia, you know, elect of God, even Yehoshua HaMashiach, whatever they say goes. And so that's not because anyone said that I thought this way or I thought another way. I just know that it's a perfect time to walk the walk, and I've asked some to humble themselves. Then I shall lead my well. I shall proceed in Yahweh by humbling myself and acknowledging truth, because if not, I would be a liar, you know, and I would then surely His Majesty would not be Iman Father. But yeah, I have no problem with that, and I'm not saying that's the case, and I'm not saying that it's not the case. But if it were the case, and if it is the case, I really don't care, you know. I'll exaggerate to go on forward and say that if His Majesty, you know, Christ in His kingly visitation, which I like that, I like how it sounds, well, because of the fact that it's true, but also, it, you know, it just shines much light to the fact, you know, His visitation, His short stay upon this planet. I just agree with that, is what I meant. Anyways, whatever Him say, His Imperial Majesty goes, you know. If I be trash, I'm not saying I'm trash or anyone's consider I trash, but, you know, for the sake of giving an idea of what I'm trying to say is that, excuse me, if I be trash, then I have no problem being trash, because that's what His Majesty wanted I to be. This is pretend, you know, this is kind of like, just to give an example, to kind of, and I'm exaggerating to express how it really doesn't matter what I think. I didn't earn this life. I don't deserve to be alive. Nothing that I've done has led me to the point that I am. And so what makes I think that I even have the right to even decide, you know? So whatever His Majesty and His Christ, yes, who's Yehoshua, say goes. And I'm down with that. You know, I'm up for that, rather. That's what it is, you know? And I pray that maybe in the times after this, like Yehoshua say, anyone that bow it down to I might pick up, you know? And, you know, the low was raised high, and the high was made low, and so just pray for that. And if it be that in the times to come, I am lowered even more, then so be it. You know, I didn't create myself, you know, and so, I know who I worship, you know, and I'm okay with that, with whatever Him that I worship on, I to be. And so, you know, I just wanted to testify to that because of this whole Gentile talk. And I'll be what His Majesty want I to be, you know? And so, because I and I covenant is with Him and His Christ. And, you know, and it all relates to this week's Senbit study. So I hope that I explained myself right. As far as the teaching, I'm not trying to teach anyone. I just thought that I could share some of the information so that maybe on some areas that ones didn't pick up on, that maybe I could help shine some light. I ain't trying to teach nobody, you know, I'm trying to learn myself, rather. And so that be that, and the fact that I did grow up in Egypt, well, I is working out some works with Mexico and the Rastafari south of the border, but until that come to be, you know, I thought I'd just share information. I ain't trying to exalt myself like I'm trying to teach Judah or anything. I'm trying to learn with them, with all the island. So that is that. And I believe I had so yeah, one last time, this is who I and I worship. This is His Imperial Majesty. I mean, just, you know, the art that I and I work on is you know, that's, yeah, I guess Miriam looks a little light, but I didn't have the color. But her hands are darker, you know, like, and this isn't like a joke, you know, like it's honest, you know. You know, yes, as a youngster with the fro, what I'm trying to say is that I've never had no problem with the truth, and don't confuse it when I try to express how the Rastafari Beta Seb are supposed to, like, kind of like, I guess, support each other. And if that's not the case, then it's not the case. But until I've been proven otherwise, I still stand that, you know, how can Rastafari be making other Rastafari less? But hey, you know, if I stand corrected, then I have no problem repenting. I just remembered something. There's a video I personally put out. It's Rastafari Wisdom, and I not accidentally but ignorantly, I really didn't pay much attention to the matter, but I included a picture where a hand is coming out of China, and it's picking a piece, like with I don't know what they call them, like, but it's picking out like a piece from Africa. And I already changed the title, you know. I did do it ignorantly, honestly, and, you know, I'm confessing publicly that I changed the name of the title, and I kind of like I guess I wrote like a little statement saying that was not, you know, not to take that against Rastafari as a whole, rather that was my ignorance personally, and I take full responsibility for it, and that is what I'm going to say. Well, what I just said, and I'll say it again, I take full responsibility, and I pray that China if there be some connection along the way that they don't take all Rastafari accountable for the action that I personally committed. And so, yeah, that was I didn't really have any bad intentions. It was I was looking for an image that kind of represented how many different countries were interested in Africa, and you know, I ignorantly chose that one. Even that wasn't, you know, I don't in reality there is nothing negative that I say. It's just that it wasn't appropriate, rather, you know, with the, to go forth and including that image without actually going forward and you know, doing diligence to research the matter more thoroughly before I. Oh, I forgot to mention, yeah, because I, you know, the Father and the Son. If I had the other, actually, I do have a drawing of the one that is often used, but it doesn't have color. It has the dreadlocks and everything, but this one better expresses his true humanity. And like I told the brother, every second that I, every opportunity that just arrived for I to make it known that real Yehoshua was a black Ethiopian, I do make mention, you know, because it's the truth. It's not even because I'm trying to score points with anyone. It's just what it is. When Rastafari came to I wasn't looking for a color, you know. I wasn't looking for a religion either. But then I truth found I, and I happened to love truth, and I went with it. I didn't even know color was an issue until other people started bringing up the fact that others did not accept it because of the color. Then but you know, that's that. And so, but I do have to make mention that I have noticed that what I and I presented as far as the calendar of the house of Israel, Beta Israel, I and I did not do any such sun worship or anything like that. But I am beginning to accept that white European supremacists are in fact behind that, because well, for many reasons, but I'm going to use the example of Leonardo da Vinci or whatever. He actually does include many different evidences within his paintings that lead to the conclusion that group of people and whoever put forward the money for his works or however that worked out, that they in fact were trying to conceal and to use Christianity to cover up their sun worship and kind of to get the whole crowd to do it too, because of the paintings and the context of his paintings and all kinds of horrendous and blasphemous works that he did. And they all reflect a solar system worship, but that's not what I had in mind, and it's not what's in mind. It's reclaiming our dominion, rather. The skies, the heavens are ours, as Rastafari, you know? Well, it's our Father's, and more correctly, his Son's, for him, you know, to Jesus all things were given to his hand, and for him all things were created, and without nothing could be created. But these Renaissance people, that's what they're doing since Rome. They're hiding their sun worship or moon worship, whatever, with Christian, kind of like they're mixing everything up so that everyone goes along with their ideas. And I'm not going to present much information on that, but I will make mention that, you know, if you, one second please, Well, I guess, no, I don't have anything to show for that. But, okay, I'll use the Last Supper image that Leonardo da Vinci does. He does, like, for instance, he draws some of the disciples as women. But because he, in fact, is trying to depict, like, one of the disciples is Venus, and that's why he's all feminine, and that one of these disciples is Mercury, and so he does something to express that. And so that's, you know, ever since the Greeks and the Romans, that's, I believe that's what's been trying to be done, to erase the truth and to kind of deify themselves now, which leads I to the last point. You know, if you can recall, the first successful penetration of the I guess highlands of Ethiopia, the mountains and all that, the first successful penetration was in the 1500s or somewhere around that time, right? That's right around the time of the Renaissance. So I can't prove it, but I know that it's true. Well, but how can I know if I can't prove it, right? Okay, this is an opinion. But so right around the time that they penetrate, that the Portuguese more specifically penetrate the highlands of Ethiopia, right around that time the Renaissance begins, right? I'm thinking they penetrate the mountains, the barrier that Jah had placed to protect, you know, to protect Zion. So they invade and they accumulate some scriptures, you know, they steal and rob and plunder some texts, Ethiopic texts. They go back home, they read them, you know, 20, 30 years to figure them out. And you have the Renaissance, and that's where, like, the more of the whitewashing, that's right around the time of Cesar Borgia or Kaiser Borgia and the whole whitewashing. But notice how the penetration of Ethiopia with the Portuguese invading had, you know, just around that time. And if we go forward to the 1800s, 1820s, 1850s, right before the 1900s, or the turn of the, okay, well, I don't know how that works out, 1900s, 1800s, but I mean 1820, 1850, before the birth of His Majesty. There's another penetration into the Ethiopic area, and this one's British, and now this one's a little more, well, this one, I know that, for example, the Tower of Magdala, or the, not yet a tower, but in the sense of a fort, a stronghold, the stronghold of Magdala is raided and destroyed and completely, you know, completely wiped out from history. But all the, you know, all the goods that were kept in there, taken by the British and taken back to their island. And I believe Amba Mariam or is the town that now replaces the Magdala of old. But I'm thinking, you know, they find out, you know, Magdala, and they erase it from history, and they come up with their own with their own imagination of Mary Magdalene, you know, and as far as everything they stole, I believe that's when they took the sceptre. But anyways, I'm not sure of that. But continuing, so they take back all this knowledge back to England or their British Isles, and what do we have? We have give them 20, 30 years, 40 years to kind of learn the language, interpret the books, and then we have a boom in technology and study. You know, 1880s, 1870s, even 1890s all through the 1900s to the year 2000, while they're deciphering the truth and knowledge that is within these books, these Ethiopic scriptures that were once safely guarded by the monks, but now fallen into immature and unresponsible and wicked minds. If you recall, that's right around the time of psychology, sociology, the brain studies, and everything. That's when, you know, right around that time is when all that information came into the wrong hands, being the white Europeans that are immature and childish and did not grow with this knowledge. They just acquired it from one day to another, and what do you get? You get white Europeans playing around with atomic particles and creating atomic bombs and you know, building these planes with missiles. Not that it could not have been done before, but the righteousness of before did not allow for such foolishness to go on forward, you know, and because, you know, it was well known that why would anyone in their right mind devise, you know, these technologies of destruction? And so that's what I'm thinking. And you know, and now they're playing around with genes, and they're like little kids. They never learned to take responsibility for what they acquired, and you could see it all around. Like they're just, it's like they it's like a little kid with a brand new toy on his birthday. That's white European philosophy for you. My opinion. But yeah, that's I just wanted to mention that because I'm sure that ties into the whole whitewashing. And also, all throughout the 1800s, many different kinds of religions and members within the religion, I've come to find out and learn, that were proclaiming the birth of the Messiah. All throughout the 1800s, some said 1840, some said 1870, some said 1900, some said this, some said that. But the fact of the matter is that the whole white European superior system was looking towards the birth of the Messiah. And I remember even telling this person I know, telling his mom that whatever they believed in, it was some Mary White or Carrie, I don't know, some lady, right? And it's the Seventh Adventist Church or something like that. But I did a little research, and he was kind of close to the birth of Lij Teferi, the child, the man child. And I mentioned, actually, you shouldn't be disappointed. He was pretty close, you know. But I mentioned that because it's interesting how after the birth of Lij Teferi, no. That was that. No one ever made mention of the birth of a man-child or of a Messiah or the Savior or Redeemer even. It's like they skipped all of that and went straight to the end of the world. you see how it all ties in? It's like all throughout 100 years of saying that the child was to be born, and then once he's born, because of the obvious truth that he was a black Ethiopian, it's like, it's like they just forgot about that and just said, okay, well, now it's going to be the end of the world. Never mind about, see how nobody's, for the last 100 years, no one's waiting for a Messiah, you see, for a man-child to be born. They're waiting for the end of the world because the Messiah came and they know it. And so they didn't want to bow down and humble themselves to the Messiah. So now they rather look to the end of the world, and this is pretty clear, you know. That's what. Also, 1991 September 11th, when George Bush Sr. said that we finally have an opportunity, it's because the war had just ended, and it was like he said, finally, like we have a clear opening to send our Vaticanites or our Satanist Catholic leaders to infiltrate the church, because now it wasn't like war going on. Now it was like kind of like an easy entrance or opening to infiltrate the Tewahedo church, now the Ethiopian Orthodox church, and infest it with whitewashing depictions of Michelangelo paintings and Leonardo. So they've been waiting for a long time to replace these true icons and replace them with these false Antichrist images, man-made images. That's at least sticking to the context, that's what that was, an opening for the whitewashing. It'd be interesting to do some research to when were these white pictures included in the Tewahedo church. You know, was it prior 1991 or was it after? I'm guessing after. Maybe here and there one or two before, right? But I'm guessing after. So that's what that was. And you know, I kind of forgot the last point, so I'm trying to remember really quick, but it's not coming to my mind. And so, well, we give I just 1 second, please. Had to do with the I give thanks. Right around the 1700s, 1800s, they began saying that man comes from a monkey, right? And that's what they teach in universities and colleges and in schools throughout, I don't know if throughout the world, but at least in spiritual Egypt. So the fact that, you know, I'm thinking that they wanted to stick that story in this system until they could penetrate the Tewahedo church, change the images, and put the whitewashed images, and then come out with, oh, it turns out that God is true, you know. But once everything was erased, all the black history was erased, as they succeeded to do in a large way, or in a big way, I would say. But they're not successful, they've already lost, right? But they did manage to hide the truth for a while. Now, I came to that idea when I saw some, I don't know, it just came up randomly, and they pulled out one of Leonardo da Vinci's, sketchbooks. I'm not kidding when I say that they almost pulled it out of a gold cabinet, you know, and they opened this like, I don't know, it's like heavily fortified protection case after another, I don't know, like a million locks. And then they start talking about it, and the way they spoke about it was like, yeah, they want to set up their own gods, you know, they want to erase history first and then set these blasphemy people up, these satanic, well, these evildoers, you know, set them up as gods so that they could, Leonardo invented everything, you know, before he actually designed the human body. It's like they'll probably go as far as that, but it won't happen because of obvious reasons, because you know, Rastafari has been victorious, you know, the conquering lion prevailed. So that's that. And you know what the funny thing is, that just last note, that Bush Senior is like I don't know if he's reincarnated through to death, I guess, for 400 years. But it's funny how, I'm not saying that's the case, but it would make it even funnier if that was the case. So 400 years later, it's like we finally have an opportunity. See how they're all lunatic and all crazy, and it's like for 400 years they've been trying. 1991, the war is over, the civil war in Ethiopia, or the war that was going on, and now they finally have an opportunity. It's like, I'll give them that much. They ain't giving up, but they ain't going nowhere either. So yeah, that's that. You know, I give thanks for all that took the time to watch this video. Believe it or not, it's all relative to this week's Torah portion studies, Rastafari Sabbatical Study number 48, Ferrarochene, Shoftin in the Hebraic, so Shalom, give thanks. Jah be the guidance and protection of all Rastafari. Shalom.